Hello, welcome to Bite Size Med. This video is on some of the regional variations in vertebrae. The vertebral column includes a series of around 33 vertebrae arranged vertically from the cranium down. In general, this column is divided into five regions. From top down, there are 7 cervical vertebrae, 12 thoracic vertebrae, 5 lumbar vertebrae, 5 sacral vertebrae which fuse to form the sacrum, and 4 to 5 coccygeal vertebrae, which fuse to form the coccyx. In part 1, we went over the structure of a typical vertebra, the blueprint that these bones follow. Now we're going to look at some of the things that are different at each level. We'll start at the top with the cervical vertebrae. There are 7, C1 to C7. The top two, C1 and C2, are especially special, atlas and axis, and they look very different than any of the other vertebrae. So I gotta put them in another video. The rest are more like typical vertebrae, and that's what we're gonna look at, C3 to C7. We'll start with what we know, and that's a typical vertebra. This is anterior, and this is posterior, and we're looking at it from above. So what are the parts of a typical vertebra? The vertebral body, the vertebral arch, the vertebral foramen between them. The body and the arch are connected by pedicles. From the pedicles emerge laminae. Where the laminae fuse, there's a spinous process. Extending laterally are the transverse processes. Extending above are the superior articular processes, and below are the inferior articular processes. Cervical vertebrae are small. As you go down the vertebral column, the size of the vertebral bodies increases. Why? Because they have to bear more weight. So small vertebral body in the cervical region, shaped like a box. If we look at it from the front, so it's an anterior view, then the upper surface would be curved like a seat, so it's concave, while the inferior surface is convex. The vertebral foramen looks like a triangle. The arch is also small. The spinous process is small too, and it can be bifid, meaning it can be split at the end. Of the cervical vertebrae, the one with the most prominent spinous process is C7. Closest to the thoracic vertebrae. That gives it a special name, vertebra prominens, because of its prominent spinous process. On the sides of the small vertebral body are the transverse processes. They have a little foramen that we did not see in a typical vertebra. That's because it's only in cervical vertebrae. It's a space in the transverse process appropriately called the transverse foramen, or the foramen transversarium. What goes through this space? The vertebral artery. If you stack them up, it'll make sense. The vertebral artery travels through this foramen from C6 upwards, going towards the base of the brain. Eventually, this artery is going to form the circle of Willis. Since it's C6 upwards, that means C7 has a small or an absent foramen because there's no vertebral artery going through it. Along with the vertebral arteries are the vertebral veins and the sympathetic plexus. That foramen makes the transverse process look a little different. There are 2 tubercles. The one in front would be the anterior tubercle, and the one behind is the posterior tubercle. The anterior tubercle of C6 is called the carotid tubercle because the carotid artery can be compressed against it. It has a fancier name, which for the life of me I can't pronounce, but I'm going to try Chassignac tubercle. The last set of processes are the articular ones. They are more horizontal in their orientation. This kind of stuff is important for movement. The way these processes articulate with each other can permit or restrict movements in that region of the vertebral column. And we'll look at movements when we look at the vertebral column as a whole. But those are some of the special things about cervical vertebrae. The next 12 vertebrae are the thoracic vertebrae. They form a part of the thoracic cage. A very obvious thing that they would have is something to attach them to the ribs. Those are costal facets. Again, we bring back the parts of the typical vertebra. Here, the vertebral body is supposed to be heart-shaped when you look at it from above, while the vertebral foramen is circular. The spinous process is much longer here and angled posteroinferiorly, so they overlap with the vertebra below, backwards and downwards. that restricts movement, in addition to the more vertically oriented articular facets. Cervical vertebrae had more horizontal, flat facets, which allows more movement in the neck region. Here they're more vertical, articulating with the vertebra above and below. That's why thoracic vertebrae don't allow much flexion, extension, and lateral flexion, but they do allow rotation. But again, we come back to that important thing. They are attached to ribs. If you look at it from the side, these are facets. They're costal facets because they attach to ribs. Demifacets because they're kind of half facets. This will make more sense when we look at the thoracic cage. But basically, most thoracic vertebrae have a superior one and an inferior one on the vertebral body. On each side. So two on this side and two on the other side. Each vertebral body articulates with the heads of two different ribs. The ribs start here and turn forwards going towards the sternum. So the transverse process has a transverse costal facet for articulation with the tubercle of one rib. Since here we're looking at it from above, we just see the superior costal facets. They articulate with the heads of the ribs. And the transverse processes, which are a little further away, articulate with the tubercles of the ribs. There's no transverse foramen here, unlike with cervical vertebrae. Then we have five lumbar vertebrae, L1 to L5. There's actually not much about them. They look a lot like typical vertebrae. The vertebral body is much larger because they bear weight of the upper body. The largest would thus be L5. The body is kidney-shaped. The vertebral foramen is triangular. The spinous process is shorter and stumpier than the thoracic ones. The transverse processes are long and they have an accessory process. The posterior surface of the base of the transverse process has this accessory process which attaches to muscles. There's also a mammillary process. This is on the superior articular process. So the little additions here are the accessory processes and the mammillary processes. The articular processes are vertical, like in the thoracic vertebrae, but notice that these are facing medially, that's inwards towards the midline. The superior ones face this way. The inferior ones face laterally, because they join together. Something like that. They don't have that transverse foramen, obviously, and they usually don't attach to ribs. The fifth lumbar vertebra transfers body weight to the base of the sacrum. Unlike the other vertebrae, for this we're looking at it from the front, an anterior view. So this would be superior and this would be inferior. The sacrum looks like an inverted triangle. It doesn't start out this way. It starts as separate bones, like the other vertebrae, around 5, S1 to S5. But over the course of life, they fuse in adults, later in life, forming one bone, the sacrum. But since it's formed by the fusion of vertebrae, we can see their residue in the different parts. These vertebrae get smaller and smaller, and that's because the lower ones are not bearing weight. The weight gets transferred to the pelvic girdle, so these vertebrae are not large. The sacrum forms the posterior part of the pelvic cavity, making its anterior surface the pelvic surface, since it faces the inside of the pelvic cavity. It also has a posterior surface and two lateral surfaces. The lateral surfaces are articular surfaces. They look like ears, so they're called auricular surfaces. Each one articulates with the ilium, forming the sacroiliac joints. The superior surface of the first sacral vertebra forms the base of the sacrum. If it has a base, it has an apex. The fifth sacral vertebra will form the apex. Because the five vertebrae are arranged one below the other from base to apex. The body of the first sacral vertebra thus articulates with the fifth lumbar vertebra, and the fifth sacral vertebra articulates with the coccyx. On either side, there are these wing-like projections. They're called the ala of the sacrum. The anterior projection of the body of the first sacral vertebra is called the sacral promontory. And you're going to hear about this a lot when you're studying obstetrics. The pelvic surface has foramina, openings. They're called the anterior sacral foramina, while the posterior surface has posterior sacral foramina. This is for spinal nerves to leave the vertebral column, which usually happens between vertebrae and the other parts of the vertebral column. But here those vertebrae have fused, and that's why they look like this. Let's bring back a typical vertebra so we can see which parts fuse to create what. The pelvic surface has transverse lines. That's where the vertebrae have fused. The posterior surface would have residual structures from the vertebral arch and its processes. That's these five longitudinal ridges. They are sacral crests. In the center, there's the median sacral crest. That's where the spinous processes have fused. There are lateral sacral crests, which would be the outermost. This is where the tips of the transverse processes have fused. And in between are the intermediate sacral crests, which are fused articular processes. Median, lateral, and intermediate sacral crests. The fifth sacral vertebra doesn't have a spinous process or laminae. That leaves a space called the sacral hiatus, which leads into the sacral canal. The sacral canal would be formed by the fusion of vertebral foramen of all five sacral vertebrae. What would that have? The spinal cord usually would have ended above this. So the sacral canal, which is a continuation of the vertebral canal, would have the cauda equina, which continues from the spinal cord, along with the phylum terminale and the spinal meninges. It also has the lateral sacral vessels. On either side of the sacral hiatus are horns called the sacral cornua, and this sacrum articulates with the coccyx. That's the tailbone. It's small because it doesn't bear weight, and it's also triangular like the sacrum, with the largest being the first coccygeal vertebra, which is the one that articulates with the sacrum by the coccygeal cornua. This too starts off with 4 to 5 vertebrae, but fuses over time. It too has a pelvic surface and a posterior surface like the sacrum. And with that, we've reached the end of the vertebral column. That's 7 cervical, 12 thoracic, 5 lumbar vertebrae, the sacrum, and the coccyx. And that's some stuff about how they all differ. I hope this video was helpful. If it was, you can give it a like and subscribe to my channel. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.